Okay. Hello everybody. This is going to be my second video. This might come in a few different parts for this project. As you can see, I've already begun. It's a headless horseman. The Celtic headless horseman. I can't remember the name, and I'm sure I won't pronounce it right anyway. It's something like Gan Ceann or something like that. The Celtic version. He keeps his severed head under his left thigh and uses a human spine as his whip. So I kind of changed that and I put the little skull over here with some runic writing. And yeah, so just fun little piece for Halloween. So we're going to begin on this. And I'm sure I won't get it done with this video, so there'll be another video coming. But if any of you have any questions, you can email me at Christopher Katt, that's spelled K-A-T-T, fineart@gmail.com. So, working on the interior of his cape right now. A lot of times I work in basically layers. I'll start off light and then come back to it and kind of build on it as I need to darken it up. And as I've explained to other people on Facebook, and I might even mention this in my last video, I'm not really sure. Do not be afraid to go dark. I see a lot of people that, you know, they may just be beginning, you know, the pyro art, or, you know, they might have a couple of years into it. Some I've seen even as many as 4 to 5 years in it. And they've got great detail. I don't mean anything against them personally, but it's light and it doesn't really pop. It doesn't really stand off the page, and it's not very eye-catching as a result. It's got great detail, great line art, or line work, I should say. But it just, because it lacks that contrast, I guess, is the word I'm looking for, it just really doesn't capture the imagination at all. So, if you're a pyro artist, woodburner, whatever you want to call yourself, do not be afraid to go dark. And if you screw it up, start again on a different piece and learn, you know, what you can from the previous work. So, and that brings up another topic I wouldn't mind discussing right now, that I learned from an artist friend of mine few years ago, and that was the idea of holding on to your works. And like, if you do really an extraordinary work, you know, some artists don't want to put it up for sale or gift it or, you know, whatever. They want to hold on to it forever. Well, if you consistently work on your art, at some point you're going to eclipse that piece. You're going to get better. So it really doesn't matter. And by holding on to a piece like that, that's, in a way, that's kind of like showing, I don't know, like a lack of confidence in a way, you know, saying that like, you'll never be able to do that again. When in fact, if you were to restart it, maybe even a couple times it might take you, but more than likely, you'll be able to do even better job. So that's just kind of something to take away. And when we first discussed that, I was like, yeah, but I got all this great stuff I don't want to get rid of. And that was another reason for bringing it up, is that I had all this old artwork. And some people like to hold on to it, as a measure of how far they come, you know, as an artist, how they've come along. And that's fine, to a certain degree, I think. I mean, I can kind of understand that. But after that discussion, I really got to thinking about it. You know, am I holding on to all this artwork? Because I had this huge white plastic bin, you know, with the snap lid and everything. And I was just holding on to all this stuff. And pretty soon I was going to have another really big bin. You know, that was before I got the wood burning. I was doing more kind of ink works and a little bit more comic-y type style thing. In fact, I think I was entertaining the idea of getting into comics, maybe. I'm glad I didn't. No offense to those who are in it, but from what I understand, it's a pretty tough road. And I was also an anime art at that time, but had all this stuff. And I wasn't even taking it out of the box ever and looking at it, so that's like, you know, that's another question to ask yourself. You're keeping it to see how far you've come. Are you ever really, I mean, do you ever pull it out of the box and look at it to measure how far you've come, you know? And plus with, you know, modern day technology where you can keep, you know, picture and video archives of all your different works. I mean, what's the sense of holding on to it? And you know, some people may disagree with that, but I mean, it was all the storage space in my studio was getting hogged up by this thing. So I went through it, and some of it I would just give to my kids. It's like, here, you know, if you want this, great, take it. Otherwise, I'm gonna pitch it or burn it or whatever. And you know, so they took a few of them to put up in their room, and or they want me to frame it, which I'm not really gonna round to, but. You know, and give it away as gifts to friends and family, but I would just kind of caution any artist, you know, that holds on a little too tightly to any one or collection of works. I mean, I think you should always be pushing forward and try to do better. Don't be afraid to restart a work. I mean, if it's a decent work, you think you can sell it, you know, and it's not going to mar your artistic, I don't know, the way people look at you, I guess. Then yeah, go ahead and sell it, and then you can always kind of restart it. If you think it's going to really make people look badly upon you or your ability, you know, maybe you should just get rid of it and start over. And don't be afraid to start over. I mean, don't be afraid to do some work, because that's just going to hold you back. I mean, it's not that I don't understand. I definitely understand. I've had times where I've kind of penciled out a design that I want to wood burn and love the design, and for some reason it just doesn't, I'm not able to get it the first time burning it. Whether it's, you know, I just didn't visualize it quite right before I got started, or I didn't plan ahead well enough, which I'm guilty of a lot of times. I just kind of charge forward. I'm like, well, I'll figure it out as I go. That's something I'm definitely guilty of. But, you know, sometimes that happens. Sometimes when you run into a problem like that, you can kind of walk away from it for a bit and come back later and fix it, you know, be in a better frame of mind. And sometimes you can't. Sometimes you just gotta scrap it. And when that happens, you know, don't be afraid to do that. I don't think you should ever put so much self-importance in one work that you can't start anew. Whether you've completely just pitched the starter one, or maybe you've sold it and like, okay, and but you want to do another one. I keep toying around with the idea of an ink work I did a long time ago. It's called Shattered Images, and it was spiritualistic work, there was a lot of symbolic meaning to it. And, you know, way back, I thought, well, no, that's already done. But now, you know, I don't have as much of a hang-up about restarting work or just trying again and doing even better. And even not just in how real the image would look. It's kind of hard for me to explain this without showing you the image. But not just in, you know, in terms of how clean the work would be, the detail, the realism, but also the concept itself. You know, if I could do a concept that would be more dynamic, more eye-catching. You know, I've thought about doing that sort of thing. And I probably will. And just to kind of, for those who are interested on projects that I'm presently working on and what I have planned for the future to go from here, as you can tell, this is like the second Halloween piece I'm doing. I plan to do about four of them. And if people, you know, if they end up selling and, you know, people end up grabbing them up or whatever, then I'll make a few more. But, you know, it's just that time of year's coming around. And the nice thing about Halloween works, it's kind of like fantasy work, and I love fantasy work. I'm kind of an oddball. I like kind of symbolic, spiritual, theology kind of styled work. I want to be careful how I say this. I'm not a big fan of typical Christian work. And I do consider myself a Christian, and it's not that I think that there's anything wrong with it. It just doesn't float my boat, you know? Coffee break. And just to kind of explain myself on that, there's nothing wrong with it, obviously. I mean, it's good work. It's good, solid. And most people do good, solid work, realism. I mean, I've seen some really impressive ability in some of those works. But I guess it's just that so much of it is the same thing, is what I'm trying to say. I see, you know, so many renditions of the crucifixion without really doing anything different with it. I see so many images of Christ, and he has all these lambs around him. I see so many images of Christ, and he's got children around him. And it's just kind of the same old themes. And it's not that everywhere. I know that there are a few that are doing some different works, and those I enjoy. But it's seeing the same ones just rehashed over and over and over again. And I don't mean it in a sacrilegious way, obviously. But I'm one of those, I like to see new ideas. I like to see a new twist on something. Without, of course, mucking up the message. You know? I'm working on presently, not right here in front of me, but once I get these Halloween works done. Oh, and I am working on another project. I don't want to really discuss it this time. It's kind of a... not really ready to unveil it just yet, but I probably will be doing a Kickstarter for it. It's just something I do in my spare time. It will not be wood burning. But I think people, nonetheless, who like my fantasy work will really enjoy it. So, but it'll be kind of like a side project until I get a little further with it. It really shouldn't take me that long. So, but in terms of just the wood burning, once I get the Halloween works done, I plan to get back to, excuse me, more Christian-based works for a little while. I'm in a gallery presently over in Salem, Massachusetts. You can see my works along with many others. It is, let's see, Boston Woodturning Gallery. I think you can go to bostonwoodturninggallery.com and see it. I haven't really looked at it that much. I've sold a couple pieces. Those have been more nautical in nature. I want to try to find a gallery that's not necessarily to replace, but, you know, in addition to. I want to find one that that would be a good gallery for my Christian-based work. Which, I don't know, it might be kind of tough to do. Because my Christian-based art has a certain level of intensity to it. A friend of mine, his name's Gabe. He's a youth pastor at our church. And I remember talking to him about it, and he's seen some of my works. And I think I've shown him some work in progress pictures of the one right now that I'm working on, God Does Not Rape. Does not rape. and yes, the title is a little intense as well, provocative maybe. And the reason being is that it's an intense message. It's a work that explains the reason for the existence of evil. And because that is one that I hear a lot of people that struggle with spiritualism, struggle with God, struggle with those concepts, you know. Struggle with the idea that we're living in a broken world. And why? Why is it like that? And so, based on certain lectures that I've listened to and studies of my own, I've kind of took it upon myself to come up with a symbolic work. It's, you know, I don't know if it's something that God put in my head, how much of it is Him and how much of it is me, or maybe it's all Him, I don't know. But a lot of times I hear these lectures or whatever, and this visual pops in my head. And I got to put it down. I got to, you know, create it in essence. I got to put it to visual form. Because if I don't, it starts to nag at me. And not that I don't want to work on it, I do. But it's one of those things that's kind of funny. Because it'll just... It's like it's in the back of my head, and it just keeps tapping away at me until I do it. So, but, yeah, that's something I plan to get back to. It's actually near completion. So, that's one I want to do. And it's like I, you know, based on the title alone and my brief and not full explanation of the work... I mean, I think it's pretty easy to tell that it's an intense work. And I think some Christian galleries would shy away from it. Because I've seen a lot of Christian galleries where they like the happy fuzzy, you know, God with the lambs, God with the children. And, you know, they accept also the, you know, the crucifixion. I mean, because you kind of have to. I mean, if you're going to have a Christian gallery, you can't really not have the crucifixion. But I think... A lot of Christian galleries, they want to present Christianity as the gospel without the law. And it's really kind of a culmination of the two. And I think that's why a lot of times people shy away from Christianity is the law, and that it's the intensity and the expectations. But you have that in life anyway, don't you? And a lot of people may disagree with me, and that's fine. That's okay. I'm kind of a weird Christian. I take that, you know, don't judge others, pretty literal. I mean, I try really hard not to judge others. Just because I know in my own life I've been such a screw-up at times. But And so many, you know, have looked past that and accepted me into their lives. That, you know, how can I not do the same for others? That's not to say that I agree with, you know, some stuff a lot of people do. And you got to be careful with that kind of that separation of the two. Not judging somebody does not mean to accept any sense of immorality. Doesn't mean to accept any sense of lawlessness. It doesn't mean to accept any sense of really bad judgment, really bad behavior. You can deal with somebody and their lawlessness and their immorality while still not passing judgment on them. And it's kind of a fine line in it. And I can't say for sure what the perfect balance is, but I do understand the principles behind it. But it's one of those things, it's one thing to understand the principle, but to perform it in your own life on a day-to-day basis, not so easy. But I'm just one of those people. I tend to look at life that, you know, we're all kind of bumping around in the dark. It is a broken world. And I think that's what most people can agree upon, with maybe very few exceptions, is that this is a broken world. So I think we all need to give each other a little slack based on that. Because it's hard, you know? I wasn't planning to get into all that kind of discussion for this, but there it is. Just delivered that Raven work that you saw in the last video. Gal really loved it, so that was pretty cool. I love it when you do work for somebody and they are, I mean, it's so obvious that it's not just put on, that they're not just, you know, feigning excitement. I mean, she generally was enthralled about the work, and I love that. You know, knowing that it's going to go to somebody who's really going to treasure that work. So, that was really cool. That really made my day. That was just yesterday, so. You know, everything after that was just, you know, whatever. You know, it was just a great day. Hard not to have a good day when something like that happens, you know? But anyway, back to this. Yeah, the Headless Horseman, like I said, the Celtic version, the head, the severed head is kept under the thigh, but I, of course, did something a little different here. You know, whether it's mythology or my own fan-based work on somebody, I always got to, you know, make it my own somehow. I don't know if that's a little bit of ego, which I certainly have. I'm not going to even pretend that I don't. But, you know, God, you know, and the Bible says that, you know, we're a reflection, we're a mirror of God, that he made us in his image. And I think an artist can understand that probably just about better than anybody because of the creative process that we go through. And that's why, and going back to that subject of rooting through your artwork and not being afraid to pitch it sometimes, because, you know, they, in a sense, kind of become your baby, you know, and you don't want to pitch them, you know. But especially if you have an opportunity to sell them and somebody has a chance to enjoy them, by all means, do that. You know, get a little extra money for yourself. And if it's somebody who's going to really treasure it, that's great. Because you can always create more. You know, whether it's wood burning or painting or you work with ink or, you know, whatever the case may be. Don't stifle yourself and think that you can't replicate the same thing or do even better. Because that's the goal, is to do better, to grow as an artist. For those of you that are only just beginning to do wood burning or thinking about beginning, sometimes it may look like I know exactly what I'm doing with this and I have some ideas. I'll say this. Probably about 75 to 80% of this when I'm doing shading and fill work, yeah, I know what I'm doing. The other 20 to 25%, I'm seeing what the wood will allow me to do. And, you know, if you ever heard that old saying about a sculptor where, you know, the work is already in the stone, they're just freeing it. And I was like, okay, yeah, I've heard that, sure. But as a pyro artist, as a wood burner, I think I understand that a little bit better now, because when you're dealing with a natural medium, you are, to some extent, a little bit at the mercy of the canvas, you know? It's we don't have the benefit that, and I'm not picking on painters or, you know, pencil artists or, you know, whatever, because, yeah, you might have some inconsistencies, but, you know, by and large, you know, painter buys a canvas, it's fairly consistent. If you're a pencil sketch artist, I mean, you're buying paper that's tightly knit, and for the most part, it's fairly consistent. Same with inkers, if you work with markers, if you work with color pencils, charcoal, you know. It's not so much for those artists, but if you're working with a natural medium, and I think easily with wood burning is a very close match to a sculptor, in that you're at the mercy of the natural medium of it. Because I'll have soft spots, hard spots, I shouldn't point this out, but there's a little dark spot that's already there. It comes all the way out the back. That was not me. That was already in the piece. So, I'm just like, well, there's a shadow there. And then sometimes when I'm going along here, like right here, it was starting to draw the heat in, especially fast, must have been a soft spot. Okay, we'll put an extra shadow there. But if you kind of pull back and look, doesn't matter. It all blends. And, there's different techniques that you can use for this sort of thing. Like, obviously, you know, when I'm getting in an area and I want to get really light, when I'm trying to kind of smooth out areas, I might have, like I'm doing now, kind of fast, sketchy type movements, similar to penciling. And, you know, and I might go over that several times doing it that way, you know. And other times you can just kind of like drag like that. And you can use a combination of the two to get a better gradient. That's kind of how that works. And this has been kind of hard to work on because I want the inside. I've looked at several different images of the Headless Horseman, and I kind of was really drawn to like six different ones. I don't know who the artists are because this stuff gets passed around so much I can't even tell, and gets, you know, reposted. I'd love to give credit to the artists if I knew, but I don't know. And so I just kind of did my own hodgepodge version where I took little aspects of each and kind of, like I said, you know, made it my own. And, you know, we talked to some artists that have gone to artists, you know, some kind of art school or, you know, had more of a formal education. They'll tell you, they'll regurgitate what their professors have said, which is nothing is new. Everything is just, you know, a new rendition of the old, and it's impossible to do anything new anymore, which I think is really negative and I don't agree with. But, you know, I can kind of see the point to an extent. But, you know, maybe we're just mirroring nature, but I don't know. I just, maybe it's not so much that I disagree with that statement, but I don't like to think that way. Because it just, I don't know. It just sounds too negative. I don't like it. I prefer to think, as an artist, that you can take most anything and make it your own. As long as you're not, like, doing a direct copy, you know, and if you're doing, like, a direct copy and you're not changing it in any way, shape, or form, well, then sure, you know, give credit. And I think that's okay, too, because I think that's, as long as you're giving credit and saying, well, this is totally my own creation, in a sense, you're paying homage to that artist. You're saying, hey, this is so great, I want to do something like what you've done. And that's fine. I've listened to different programs on YouTube, or listened to different people talk about fan art versus original art. And sometimes those lines can be kind of blurred, you know? Especially when you're talking about subject matter that is, well, like the Headless Horseman. He's a myth and has been around for a very long time. And there's different, which I didn't even realize this until I started looking to doing this work, that different countries have different versions. There's a German Headless Horseman. There's a, you know, more English. There's the Celtic version. Found it rather surprising that there was all these different versions. And I didn't read all on it. I just, Celtic, yeah. I've always kind of had a thing for Celtic stuff. My wife, she's Irish. So, kind of enjoy that stuff. But as you can see, I took a finer point. A little ballpoint. Yeah, it's twisted up. I banged the crap out of this. That's just how I work, I guess. And in order to create a very intense, dark, shadowed area, and if you can see from the reflections the kind of texture that has, and then I use more of a spoon to kind of darken these areas, and now I'm trying to lighten up for the interior of the kind of cape of his long coat. So, but I think that's pretty good for now, probably because I got to get ready for church. So blessings. I'll see you at the next video.